Thank you, man. One Sunday after Mr. and Mrs. Reagan returned to Los Angeles, to Bel Air, it was their first Sunday in the Bel Air church. They hadn't been able to come to church in all those months leading up to it because of they had other things to do, like being president of the United States. But so it was the first time he was at Bel Air, he and she. And it was great to have him. But also that morning, the coach of the UCLA-USC football team that UCLA team that had just beaten USC the day before was in attendance. Many of you remember Homer Smith. He was the coach at the time. So I rose to the occasion and said, "We are so pleased today to have with us in attendance for the first time in a long time, Homer Smith, UCLA's victorious coach." Well, I thought Mr. Reagan would fall off the pew. He laughed so hard. But he was a great, great friend of the church and was there every chance he had to worship God. We never saved any seats for anyone, because you begin doing that in a church where there are a lot of celebrities and you're in trouble. Right. Yeah. And I remember one Sunday morning sitting up front, of course, the service was just about to begin, and a very ambitious usher came forward, and there were two people sitting here in the front pew, the second pew, where the Reagans usually sat. And the usher said, "Excuse me, but would you please move to sit somewhere else? The president and his wife is here." And so these two guys made their way to the back and sat down. And I saw this whole thing happening. I'm standing up in front, actually. And then they came and sat down, and I made a beeline to those two guys sitting in the back. And I said to them, "As long as I'm pastor of this church, that'll never happen again. We don't save seats for anyone." And then after the service, I apologized to the Reagans for the impetuous actions of the usher, and they were very pleased, and they were very embarrassed that they were recognized and saved, had those saved seats. They were a very humble part of our church, and we were so honored to have them there, but we were honored to have everyone there, all the strong ones, the weak ones, the wise ones, the foolish ones, the rich, the poor. They were all there. Why am I here? Oh, I better read the scripture. Yeah, let's follow the scripture. Now I say this not to put you down, but to remind you, this is Jesus speaking.
Yeah.
Jesus wrote this. Do we have that somewhere? Okay. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor about your body, what you shall put on. Well, then, you want to say that kind of, that's easy for you to say. Is not life more than food? Yeah. And the body more than clothing? Yes. Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and let your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit to your span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O people of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles all seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you as well. Thank you, Lord, for your truth of the Word of God. Amen. Well, this is a challenge. I'm not used to getting on when you want to get out. Oh, forget it. Yeah, it's easy for you guys to say. No, I am. I'm very pleased to be here and to be a part of this worship service with you. I'm very grateful for Zach and his friendship and the opportunity that he gives me every now and then to share the faith with you. The lesson of the lilies. Do not worry, is what Jesus said. Oh, golly. It is such a democratic problem because we all have those tendencies. I mean, moving from Bel Air, where we were for 50-some years, to Pasadena, where we now live, in a very nice retirement center, there have been a lot of anxieties and a lot of worries. And even once we got into the facility, I mean, all of the common worries that you would bring with you to a place like that. And then you pick up the scriptures and he says, don't worry about anything. That's not good news, that's bad news. But every time the Lord would say something like that, he's trying to say, I want to liberate you. Yeah. I don't want you to be burdened. Yeah. I don't want you to be heavy. I don't want you to be locked in. I want you to be free. Yeah. Like the flowers of the field are free to be flowers. Like the animals of the field are free to run and move and be who I created them to be. I created you to be a part of the kingdom. So seek first the kingdom. Seek first God's rule. You're not going to be weird if you do. You're just going to be whole the way I created you. So, but you and I know how worry can infest us and dog our heels. Sometimes it's hard to sleep because we're anxious. Carol, my wife, just so she's not here today, she has another church she likes to go to because she likes the pastor.
Yeah.
She'd already heard this pastor. No. But she carries worry often to bed. Little petty things. But you carry worry to bed with you, and it's like wearing a pack on your back trying to sleep. But it doesn't do any good to say, don't worry. Because you've chosen that. It must have payoffs or we wouldn't do it. By brooding over uncontrollable events, we can escape whatever it is that threatens us most. Procrastination often seems easier than taking responsibility for an immediate act. Put it off. Why do today what you can put off until tomorrow? If I can worry about the future, I don't have to act in the present. Vincent Peale had a person come to him one time. You remember Vincent Peale, the pastor of New York, a church in New York City? And a person came to him and was really burdened. And so they finally got down to it, and Peale said, well, why are you here? What's your big burden that you bring today? And he says, well, my problem is I have a stack of mail in front of me every day when I go to work. And of course, Peale said, well, what do you do about it? He said, I just brood over the stack of mail. It's so cumbersome. It's so heavy. It's so difficult. He says, I challenge you to go back tomorrow. And don't go to the second letter until you've answered the first. Take one letter at a time and answer it. And the next, even if you have to say, I'm sorry, I don't have an answer to that right now, but I will get back. Answer every one of them. Don't push any of them aside. He saw the guy a couple of days later. He said to this fellow, you look differently. He says, I am different. He says, Peale said to him, you look like you have a great peace. He says, I do. He says, what happened? He says, I answered my mail. Why do we do it? We know that intellectually, but why do we do it? Why do we put off? There must be some payoffs to worry, anxiety, fretting. There must be some payoff. Right now, I'm in a new situation over there in Pasadena. And little diddly, piddly things occupy a lot of my time thinking. Sometimes it's really helpful to worry because you don't have to act. You don't have to kick into gear. So worry about it. That's a payoff. But it doesn't answer the problem. Another payoff is It avoids the risk. The longer you can procrastinate, the more you're avoiding any risking of failure. You begin to act, you take the chance. You may succeed and you may fail. But that's life, isn't it? That's what life is all about. Right now, you're brooding over a particular issue, a need, a problem. What are you going to do about it? Tomorrow, you're going to be the same way? What are you going to do as far as action is concerned? Certainly, there are payoffs, but one of the payoffs, by the way, is that I can appear to other people who know me, I can appear to them as a caring person, because I care about you. And people know that, and know that I as a pastor, care about my congregation, and I worry about them and anxious about them, of course. That's a payoff. But those kind of anxieties keep us from a free relationship with God. It doesn't in my life. I'm over there in Pasadena now, and little things creep in. A letter that needs to be mailed, and it's been sitting there for 2 days, and it's been written, and it's all addressed and everything, but I just haven't gotten into the... Don't... If you can worry about it, you can put off the risk. But take the letter and put it where it should be so it goes out. Why waste one more moment? My wife, she couldn't be here today. She could be here today, but she's heard me preach before. No, she had some other things that she had to do. But she goes to bed often at night with petty little anxieties. You go to sleep with worry, and you're sleeping with a pack on your back. And she often can't get on the other side of it. Now, I'm going to skip a lot of things, but let me get to the end of this. What is the suggestion of the scriptures? This is Jesus talking. He's talking to you, he's talking to me about anxiety. Do the lilies struggle? Lilies don't struggle. Do animals struggle? No. They have their needs and they find ways of having them met, but Jesus is using lilies for us to say, relax. And then what's the solution? Jesus says, this is his word, seek ye first great things for yourself? No. Seek first the kingdom of God. That's very grandiose, isn't it? Seek first the kingdom of good. God's rule in your life. You let those worries, those anxieties flip around in your mind at night. And every time you look at those things, look 10 times at the resurrection powerful Lord Jesus Christ. He is sovereign. You're not. And the old guy was worried about a lot of things, and he prayed and he said, Lord, there's no use for us both being up tonight. So I'm surrendering this to you. Give me peace. Because as I say, you go to sleep with trying to get on the other side of worry and you have a pack on your back. No. You deal with the issue. Deal with the problem. Deal with the pain. Deal with the unfulfilled expectations. As you submit them to the King, seek ye first the kingdom. And this sometimes this takes real concentration. It's not just a flippant little prayer. It's a deep meditation on the kingly rule of Christ in your life. I've had to this last week stop in many kind of grubby activities that I was involved in. Stop. You are a child of the King, Moomaw. Get your eyes focused on me. Mm-hmm. Get them off of the hole of the donut.
Right. That's good. That's good.
Get your eyes and your spirit. You're a spiritual man, Moomaw. Let me reign as King. Sometimes you have to really be tough on yourself. But being that way is divine surgery that just cuts out all the garbage and helps you break through to let God handle those issues. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. And all these things that you think are so worthy of your worry, can you, by worrying, add one cubit, it says in the scriptures, to your life? Well, but it's got to be done. I can't just procrastinate and not plan my day. No, he's not saying be lethargic in that. Not at all. He's saying you have some responsibility to do it. But don't let it wallow around in your subconscious. Don't let it become for you the edge. Go over the edge to seeking first the kingdom of God, kingly rule of Christ. Now I'm saying this wanting to sound pretty simple. It isn't simple, I know that. Sometimes you really have to stop. And right now, stop. Stop it. You're thinking about how you're going to make that payment. Stop it. Seek first the kingdom of God. God's rule in your life. God, help me in this. God, help me take the first step. God, don't let me just wallow around in this every day. Give me the first indication of your love. This morning, right now, take that step of faith. Lord, you are the King. And you are my righteousness. I don't have to work for righteousness. I don't have to work to get better and all the rest. Oh, so there's some things I have to drop off and so on. But that's the business of God, to convict us of that and to get us going. And boy, the more you can release of those things that hold you back, the tendencies for avarice, the tendencies for selfishness, the tendencies for protection, all pretty natural for all of us. Being released of that is letting God be God. Oh God, I want you to be God in my life. Lord, I'm over in that new neighborhood over there. There's so many things that I see wrong and so many things that in my own life that need to be readjusted. But you are Lord. You are God. Seek ye first my kingdom. Oh, help me to do that today. Lord Jesus, help us as a group to do that today, as a congregation, as individuals, to let you be the reigning King. So often I live as though everything depended upon me. Forgive me, O God. Forgive me for saying one thing about my belief in you and then acting like a vowed practicing agnostic. No, I want to believe in you and surrender to you and let you, as God of the creation, let you take responsibility for my life. Bless this congregation and make them a blessing. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Help us spread the message. Click on the donate button below or go to shermanoakspc.org/donate. Thank you.